So I have shown you this picture in the beginning, and you made very interesting remarks on these pictures. It suggests that philosophy is an important enterprise, but when we come to define philosophy, when we try to understand philosophy as such, then we encounter problem. And it is this very problem which is the core in the philosophical enterprise. It is this very thing, the disagreement on the very definition of philosophy, reflects the essential practice, what we call philosophy. This is not true of any other discipline, in fact. If you consider what is physics, the scientists agree on a definition that yes, this is physics. What is biology? What is mathematics? What is sociology or any other discipline? So largely you find a consensus on the very understanding of the discipline and the expression, the meaning of that expression. Here, when we see philosophy means different things in different mouth, this is essentially the philosophical practice. It does not mean that we cannot make any pragmatic sense of what philosophy is. We do make a sense of philosophy in general, and then from there we advance, we try to develop our own ideas. So, in order to have the agreed understanding of what philosophy is, we usually refer to its etymology, the very expression and from where it is coming. Just look at point one below what is philosophy. It says that philosophy is understood as the love of wisdom. What it means is that we long for knowledge, we long for wisdom in any area, right? So if you break the concept philosophy into two popular notions by using the Greek words, philos, which means love, and sophia, which means knowledge or wisdom. So this way you try to understand etymologically what philosophy means. It's a kind of inquiry, and the inquiry is targeting to generate knowledge, wisdom in human mind. And when we understand knowledge and wisdom in this sense, we do not differentiate between what we call knowledge and understanding. Yesterday I was talking that philosophy is not meant for supplying information or generating knowledge. Instead, it is meant for creating understanding in human mind, right? So when we say that it is not meant for information or knowledge, instead it is meant for generating understanding, we do differentiate between knowledge and understanding. So if you try to correlate information, knowledge, and understanding, there you will see that information is coming in terms of the data available in our surrounding. And when we make sense of that data in some relational terms, when we try to relate the available data, the discrete data, we try to relate and see the interrelationship between those data, then we acquire knowledge. So knowledge is basically the acquisition of information with understanding of relationship between that information. But knowledge is in that sense restricted to only some kind of cognitive activity. Knowledge is not taken in a wider way. Knowledge is taken in a sense that it is some kind of cognitive effect in our mind, And the basic feature of the cognitive effect is that whatever data we acquire in its true sense. It's not that we are seeing something, but the reality is in any other way. Consider the cases of illusion. When there is any such event, illusion, when we mistake something, then we say that whatever we know does not correspond to what is the reality. And this way we try to differentiate between information, just information, and knowledge. Information is just a kind of bits. It is stored somewhere. That store may be your mind, it may be just your computer. And in that way, information is quite detached from any kind of cognitive understanding when we try to make sense of information. But when our cognitive process is engaged in acquiring that information and seeing the relationship between them, so when it is correctly represented by your mind, we call it knowledge. But then just by knowing does not generate understanding. For understanding, we do require reflection on the relationships between information. And when we reflect, then what happens to us? When we reflect so that when there is any occasion to behave in certain ways, then we take wise decisions. We take proper decision. When we make proper decision, when we conduct properly on the basis of our knowledge, then we are called wise. We can be called wise only when we act on our knowledge. And in that sense, we can claim that yes, we have understanding. We have understanding because we have disposition to act on our knowledge. And when there is any occasion, we act actually on that. Now, to instantiate this claim, you can say that, yes, I know that telling lie is bad. But then you know that, yes, telling lie is bad. But do you follow this in your behavior? Do you actually behave in conformity to the knowledge which you have? So we see that, yes, that is not the case always. Sometimes we tell lie, right? And sometimes we tell lie for not good reasons, for some kind of very irrational reasons. Now, what happens in that case? One can easily say that I do not understand precisely that telling lie is bad. I know that telling lie is bad, but I don't understand it. So one can question your understanding when you do not translate your knowledge in your behavior, right? You cannot be called wise. You cannot be called a person with understanding. So this way we differentiate between information, knowledge, and understanding. But look at this etymological definition. When we say philosophy means love of knowledge or wisdom, here knowledge or wisdom is taken in a comprehensive sense, in a sense where we know precisely what is the case, and also when we know that that is the case, then we don't fail to behave according to our knowledge. And in certain cases, we do realize, yes, we know that if we jump before a train, we are going to crash. So we don't jump in front of a running train. We know that if we jump from a hilltop, we will die. The law of gravitation will take its course. And therefore, we don't jump. Right? So we know that this thing will happen, and therefore we don't do something, or we do something in certain ways. So it is basically the relationship between our knowledge in our mind and its translation into our behavior. So when we translate our knowledge in our behavior with all sincerity, we don't fail to do that, we can be called a wise person. We can be called a person with understanding. So we know that just knowledge is not enough. We need to act on the knowledge. So philosophy is what philosophers do. That was the thought I floated, I offered for your reflection. And what the philosophers do in their acts, philosophers try to generate some understanding towards our life and the surrounding reality. That's the job of a philosopher, right? So this is the essential practice. The ultimate objective is to generate understanding, and understanding with reference to our life and anything which surrounds us. Philosophical discussion is to generate understanding than to merely term is important. It's not that you will not get any information which you don't know, or you will not gain knowledge. That will be there, but it will not stop only there. Actual philosophizing, the actual job of a philosopher begins after the acquisition of information and knowledge. So we will have necessary information, necessary knowledge, and then we will try to reflect so that we generate some kind of understanding. And we also know that understanding is required for living a harmonious life, and therefore philosophy is supposed to be an integral part of the social and political life of any age, because a harmonious life is our aspiration. It is our basic aspiration that we live peacefully, we live harmoniously within the individual life, within our family, in the society, and in the whole world. And for that, we require understanding. There are disturbances in the world, and that is the sign that there is a lack of understanding in the people. And remember, every child is born blind, and therefore it is a consistent effort which is required to generate understanding, and the enterprise must go on. It's like learning how to walk, how to speak, learning how to drive. So understanding is also a necessity of our life, and that we know. Our individual life, if it is not a balanced life, this is the sign. This is the sign that we don't have understanding. हम कुछ भी खाने लगते हैं, कुछ भी पहनने लगते हैं, किसी भी तरह से चलने लगते हैं. In all irrational ways, we do so many things, and that is the evidence that we lack understanding. Similarly, when we interact with our family members, then we see, yes, sometimes there is quarrel, and in some family there may be always a disturbance. The disturbance is the evidence that the members of that family lack understanding. There may be a difference in degree, but certainly the members of the family lack understanding, and that is why there is not so peaceful family life. And you are familiar with the social disturbances. That is again an evidence that the people of the society do not have understanding, proper understanding. So philosophical discourse is meant for generating understanding. That is the conclusion of this whole discussion. If philosophy is meant to generate understanding, and understanding is necessary to live a harmonious life, and living a harmonious life is our basic aspiration, that justifies that why one should study philosophy. So in studying philosophy, what we do, what we try to explore, we try to explore that how our ancestors, how the people in the past struggled with certain philosophical problems. And we know that philosophical problems are perennial problems. They are like the requirement of walking. Every child is born, and therefore necessarily, if there is no physical problem, the child is supposed to walk at a certain age. So this is a perennial requirement of any child born in any time, that a child must start walking, child must start learning language. These are our necessary requirements. They are associated with our life. So philosophical problems are the problems of every age, and the way every child learned walking in every age, so every child born in any age must discuss, must come into terms with the philosophical issues. At this stage or later stage, everyone has to encounter these philosophical questions. The philosophical questions which pertain to our life and the things which are surrounding us. So in philosophy, these are only two matters which we explore, right? What our life is and what are the things which are surrounding us. So unless we understand properly, our life cannot be a harmonious life. So in order to do that in an academic way, in a systematic way, what we do, we try to see how our ancestors, how our predecessors dealt with these issues. And since the questions are common, and therefore there may be the relevance of the answers which they arrived at, but remember, as I said yesterday, we must explore our own answer, because we don't live up to the answers of the others. Unless we find out our own answers, we are not going to live up to that. And that will remain a kind of garbage in our mind if we just know things and we don't follow in our behavior, right? So we must know how our ancestors dealt with the problems in their age. And it is for sure that we all are confronting those issues in our time. Now the question is, do we have our ways to deal with those problems? Ancestors dealt with them and they developed certain mechanisms to solve and get an answer to those problems. And we all are facing those problems, philosophical issues. Now the point is whether we have prepared ourselves to deal with those issues. This was one reason to look into the philosophical debates, the philosophical discourse, which we had so far. So we are going to do that. And you also know that a person cannot be called educated if he or she does not have knowledge about the history, culture, and philosophical traditions of the native country. The country in which you are living, if you are not familiar with the philosophical traditions developed in that, the culture which is there, the history, then it's not that you can be just safe in your house. Unless you develop a feeling of relationship between you and the country, the nation, then you have to understand the history, culture, and philosophical traditions. Otherwise, you cannot just live a harmonious, a non-violent, peaceful life in the boundaries of your house. Because you cannot remain in your house. We are saying that, yes, in Corona times, we are almost fed up, right? So people are not following the guidelines because they can't remain in their boundary of their house. So once you go outside, again, you will require security. The way you have security inside your house, you want to have the same kind of security when you go out of your house. And it depends on how secure you feel, how long you go from your house. So, you know, it's a very interesting correlation. Feeling of security in your house, and the moment you advance, you go outside of your house, then how far away you are from that very secure place, in the same proportion you feel security. So we don't want to have a society where we have insecurity. And we see that, yes, there is a problem in our society. We don't feel as secure as we feel secure in our houses. And for some unfortunate people, even their houses are not secure. So we want to have security, and how to ensure a secure life. It is a collective requirement of all of us to be familiar with the history, culture, and philosophical traditions of our country, so that we develop a kind of emotional bonding with the country, with the nation. And we know that unless the territory of the nation is secure, we cannot be secure. Unless the people of the society have understanding, we cannot feel secure. And therefore, it is essential to study philosophy. Why we need to see it into the history? It is necessary to get the insights which are already available, developed by the humanity, by our ancestors, in order to deal with the problems of our own times. So since we have the insight, the ideas, the philosophical answers given by our ancestors, and therefore it is useful that we become familiar with those answers and see whether they are useful or we need to have some different answers. And it is not a wise decision to just put extra effort to always toil for our own answer, not learning from the experiences of the others, not learning from the wisdom developed by the others. Since those things are available to us, why can't we get advantage of that? So that is another reason to study philosophical discourse and the explorations which are already conducted by our ancestors, by our elders. And remember, that is not the end. The history doesn't stop there. In fact, the moment we come to know what the way they thought, the way they dealt with the problems, we must look beyond what they could see. So since we are banking on their experiences, their explorations, we are in a position to see farther than they could see. It's like if you sit on the shoulders of someone, so the person who is holding you on his or her shoulders cannot see farther than you. You are above that, right? किसी के कंधे पर बैठे तो जिसके कंधे पर बैठे हैं उससे आप दूर तक देख सकते हैं कि नहीं देख सकते हैं? अगर ऐसा नहीं कर सकते हैं तो ये हमारी डेफिशिएंसी होगी. तो जो भी थॉट अब तक हम देखेंगे, जो भी थॉट अब तक डेवलप हो चुके हैं, दैट इज अवर एसेट एंड देयरफॉर वी मस्ट एडवांस ओवर दैट एंड वी मस्ट एडवांस इन अ मोर इकोनॉमिकल वे, नॉट बाय पुटिंग unnecessary effort, but by taking advantage of the already developed knowledge. So we must be able to see far more than what our ancestors could see. That aspiration must be there with us, because we are banking on their experiences and we are banking on their knowledge already available to us. And thanks to internet and other facilities, we have access, we have reach to that knowledge. Of course, not in a very smooth way, but in a manageable way, we can access to that. And therefore, it is a responsibility of all of us to acquire that knowledge and also advance that knowledge, right? So it is essential that we must learn. And this is true of any discipline. Don't think that this is true of only philosophy. It is true of any discipline. You are in management, others are in economics, and you know that, yes, you will be learning already developed theories, already advanced knowledge available to you. But then you should not stop there. आप उनके कंधों पे बैठेंगे, वो विचारक, वो thinkers जिनकी किताबें आप पढ़ेंगे, वो teachers जो आपको पढ़ाएंगे, तो एक तरह से आप उनके जो knowledge है, उनका जो knowledge है, उनकी जो understanding है, उसके ऊपर आप बैठे. तो आपकी अंडरस्टैंडिंग, आपका नॉलेज तो और दूरदर्शी होना चाहिए ना, आप दूर तक देख सकें. सो फ्रॉम दैट मेटाफर वी मस्ट फील रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर डेवलपिंग नॉलेज फर्दर. सो दिस मच वी हैव डिस्कस्ड, दैट वाज कॉमन फॉर फिलोसफी. नाउ लेट अस सी व्हाट इज इंडियन फिलोसफी. सो अगेन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अ बिट ऑफ दैट, that the term Indian in the expression Indian philosophy refers to the unique character of the culture developed in the Indian subcontinent. In fact, we call this Indian subcontinent because of the uniqueness of the culture of this region. And in that sense, we have seen that this meaning of Indian in Indian philosophy is wider than the modern political meaning of Indian. The modern political meaning of Indian is as per the Constitution of India, but Indian in Indian philosophy is having a wider meaning than the political meaning which we have today. So in a brief way, you can say that the expression Indian philosophy refers to the philosophical insights developed by the seers belonging to Indian subcontinent. And that is the geographical or territorial understanding of what we call Indian philosophy. Indian philosophy is developed by the seers, by the thinkers, by the scholars, by the philosophers of the ancient India who belong to Indian subcontinent. Now, when we talk of Indian philosophy in the modern sense, that we will see a little later, and that is in fact not in the purview of the present course. And if I take that much, then it won't be possible for us to complete our task, the limited task which we are to take in this course. And therefore, I confine the discussion to only the thoughts developed by the ancient Indian thinkers. And of course, we are going to see how far they are relevant in our present context and how we can benefit from them. That will be our job in the discussion. You see, Indian philosophy, both are English expressions. And we have seen English expression philosophy and what does it mean. And we have seen what Indian means in a limited way in our context. So what we call Bharatiya, that is the understanding of Indian in Indian philosophy. Now, what philosophy is in the Indian context? This is a fresh thing which we are going to take up now in some 5-10 minutes. So what is called philosophy is called darshana, darshana. And I have put the Devanagari expression also, darshana. And you should not worry about the expression which I have here. Look at this. Let me make it a little bigger so that you can see it. There is a dash above S, darshana. For writing Sanskrit expressions, we use these marks which are called diacritical marks. Diacritical marks. When we write the words of any other language in Roman script, so we want to preserve the pronunciation, the correct pronunciation of the original expression. So we say darshana, sh, sh, alabhisha, right? So you can write either with diacritical mark or you just write darshan. You can write sh, darshan. That is fine. There is no harm. Or you can just write Devanagari expression darshan. That is also fine when we write in our answers, right? So this is a convention. We have adopted certain diacritical marks to represent the Sanskrit or Devanagari pronunciations correctly. But you should not try much on that, because that is something which is only linguistic, right? And our purpose is not to go into detail. And there are different conventions of writing that word. So if you study Indian philosophy books, you will start developing a sense of the diacritical marks, how they are written. You should not waste much of time on that. You should not invest much of time on that. Instead, you try to understand the expression itself, what darshan means. So we call Indian philosophy darshan or darshan shastra. So today we will focus on the expression darshan. If you look at the etymology, the Sanskrit etymology of this term darshan, there you see that it is derived from the word, the root word called drish, drish. So the term darshana is derived from the root word drish. And those who have some Sanskrit background, that is quite helpful. But even if you don't have, you should not worry. We are not going to use much of Sanskrit expressions. We will manage with English, but it is advantageous if you can hit upon the Sanskrit treasure or the Sanskrit vocabulary. So drish is the root word. The root word, and there are some 2000 or so root words in Sanskrit, and every word in Sanskrit is derived from a root word. So the root word drish means to see. This is a verb. Every root word represents verb. Kriya ko represent karta hai. So ye drish kaun si kriya hai? Dekhna, which means to see. So from drish root, we derive the expression darshana. And in academic way, we define this expression darshana as drishyate anena iti darshanam. I have written here the Sanskrit expression also. So those who are interested, they can write this. But certainly, you must understand what this means. So darshana is that through which we see something. Drishyate anena iti darshanam. Darshanam is that through which we see something. This is one understanding of the term darshan. Jiske dwara hum kuch dekhte hain. Aur kuch wo kya hai jo dekhte hain? Aur kuch nahi hai. Hum apne ko dekhte hain aur apne aas paas jo cheeze hain usko dekhne ka prayas karte. So this is one meaning, helpful meaning of understanding what Indian philosophy is. Bhartiya darshan kya hai? To darshan wo hai jiske dwara hum dekhte hain. And very soon you will realize that it is not eyes only, that is the literal sense. Jaise dekhna, aankh se dekhte hain na? To aankh se dekhte hain, this is literal meaning of the term darshan. Ab aankh se dekhkar hota kya hai? Aankh se dekhkar hum jante hain cheezon ko. Jo hamare samne, hamari aankhein theek hain, to hamare samne jo bhi aayega, usko hum dekhenge. देख सकेंगे, जान पाएंगे. लेकिन हम सिर्फ आंखों से ही नहीं, बहुत सारी चीजों से. जैसे इस समय आप कान से सुन रहे हैं, हम लोग पास में तो हैं नहीं, तो मैंने अपना वीडियो ऑन किया है तो आप मेरा वीडियो देख सकते हैं. लेकिन वीडियो और मेरे में तो फर्क है. तो जब आप एक्चुअली मिलेंगे तो आपको दिखेगा कि हाँ, वीडियो में तो ऐसे दिखते थे, वैसे तो कुछ दूसरी तरह भी है या थोड़ा सा डिफरेंट है. तो आंख से देखते हैं, ये जो देखना है ये इम्पोर्टेंट है. हम आंख से देखते हैं, हम कान से भी देखते हैं. देखने का मतलब जानना है. कहते हैं नहीं कि जैसे आप किसी ऑफिस में जाओ तो आपको अपना जो भी प्रॉब्लम है आपने एक्सप्लेन किया, तो वो ऑफिसर क्या कहेगा? आई विल सी इट, डोंट वरी, आई विल सी इट. तो उसका मतलब क्या है कि हम इसका निवारण कर लेंगे, इसको जान लेंगे और उसका समाधान दे देंगे, राइट? तो देखना लिटरल मीनिंग नहीं है. सिर्फ लिटरल मीनिंग से हम और बाकी चीजों को भी सोचते हैं और उसके बेस पे और चीज भी हम समझने की कोशिश करते हैं. तो जिसके द्वारा देखा जाता है वो दर्शन है. दृश्यते अनेन, दर्शनम अनेन दृश्यते इति, ऐसे आप देख सकते हैं. दर्शन क्या है? अनेन माने जिसके द्वारा, दृश्यते माने देखा जाता है. दृश्यते का मतलब देखा जाता है, अनेन का मतलब जिसके द्वारा. वो क्या है? दर्शन. दर्शन है वो जिसके द्वारा देखा जाता है. तो ये एक अर्थ हुआ दर्शन का, जिसके तहत, जिसके द्वारा हम चीजों को जानते हैं, समझते हैं, देखते हैं. द वर्ड vision or seen can be understood either literally or philosophically. So literally, जैसे हमने कहा कि आंखों से देखते हैं, कान से तो देखते नहीं, कान से कहते हैं सुनते हैं, लेकिन सुनकर भी क्या करते हैं? सुनकर जानते हैं. जैसे आंख से देखकर जानते हैं, कान से सुनकर जानते हैं, जीभ से चख कर जानते हैं, टेस्ट, जीभ से चख कर जानते हैं, छू कर जानते हैं चीजों को, किसी ने बताया उसके तहत जानते हैं, खुद देख कर जानते हैं। तो जो वास्तव में उसका जितने चैनल्स हैं वो सब हमको कुछ जानकारी देते हैं। तो जब कहेंगे कि दर्शन वो है जिसके द्वारा हम जानते हैं, तो वो सारे चैनल्स की बात हो रही, जिसके द्वारा हम जानते हैं वो सारे चैनल की, सिर्फ आंखों की बात नहीं हो रही। और क्या जानते हैं, इस दुनिया में सिर्फ दो ही चीज है, एक तो जो देखता है जो जानता है वो है, और जो बाकी चीजें जिसके बारे में वो देखता है जिसके बारे में वो जानता है वो। तो दर्शन जिसके द्वारा जाना जाता है, तो क्या जाना जाता है, जब ये सवाल करेंगे तो सीधे होगा कि इसमें दो ही चीज जानना है, मैं क्या हूं और ये जो बाकी चीज हमारे आसपास है ये क्या है, इसी को जानना है, इसी को समझना है। ये इसका फिलोसॉफिकल मीनिंग है। दर्शन वो है जिसके द्वारा हम जानते हैं, ये इसका फिलोसॉफिकल मीनिंग है, ये इसका लिटरल मीनिंग नहीं है। हम फिलोसॉफिकल मीनिंग को प्रेफर करते हैं। दूसरा, मैंने अभी उसको लिखा नहीं है बट लेट मी टेल यू, टू सी इन फिलोसॉफिकल सेंस मीन्स टू रियलाइज, टू विजुअलाइज, टू अंडरस्टैंड। फिलोसॉफिकल सेंस जो दर्शन का है उसका मतलब रियलाइज करना है, विजुअलाइज करना है। इस वजह से दर्शन का ये अर्थ हुआ कि इसका मतलब रियलाइजेशन है। दर्शन का दोनों अर्थ हो गया। पहला अर्थ तो था कि जिसके द्वारा जानते हैं, तो इंस्ट्रूमेंटल अर्थ है, इंस्ट्रूमेंट हो गया। और दर्शन जो है वो रियलाइजेशन है, जो जानते हैं वो भी दर्शन है। दर्शन प्रक्रिया भी है, प्रोसेस भी है, और जो रिजल्ट जो परिणाम है वो भी है। तो हम दर्शन शब्द से दोनों चीजों को रिफर कर रहे होते हैं, प्रक्रिया और प्रोसेस थ्रू विच वी नो समथिंग, एंड व्हाट एवर वी नो दैट इज आल्सो कंसीडर्ड एज दर्शन। सो अवर नॉलेज एंड अंडरस्टैंडिंग दैट इज आल्सो दर्शन। आप बहुत सारे लोग वैष्णो देवी दर्शन करने जाते हैं, दैट इज अ वेरी पॉपुलर एक्सप्रेशन ऑफ द टर्म दर्शन। दर्शन करने में होता क्या है, वास्तव में आप जानते हैं उसको, समझते हैं, दर्शन करते हैं, मतलब वो क्रिया है, और जो देखते हैं उसके तहत जो हमारे अंदर नॉलेज पैदा होता है, जो इंसाइट पैदा होती है, जो रियलाइजेशन होता है, उसको भी दर्शन कहते हैं। एंड वी नो दैट वी रियलाइज समथिंग, एंड व्हाट इज दैट समथिंग, इट इज नॉट समथिंग, इन फैक्ट इट इज थिंग, वी रियलाइज थिंग्स, एंड थिंग्स इंक्लूड मी and the other, the rest. So in Indian philosophy, we will learn how our ancestors, how the seers of India, Bharat, discussed how they proposed certain viewpoints regarding what we are and what are the things surrounding us. And as I said, Indian culture is a diverse culture, so is the philosophy in India, so is the darshan in India. There is no single darshan. There are philosophies, there are systems of philosophy in India. So there are various systems, and each system is a viewpoint, each system is a perspective towards what we are and what are the things surrounding us. And you will come to know those systems very soon. Every system is a perspective, every system is a viewpoint into what we are and what are the things which we see around us. So this way we will proceed.